Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Well, the presence of God is strong in this place. Hallelujah. Right now, we just thank you, dear Jesus, for visiting us, Lord, in your presence, Lord. Thank you, Father. As we press in, more and more into knowing him, to being in his presence, to be with him, to communicate with him, to learn from him, to learn from his word, as we take the time every morning to seek his word, to seek his face. Oh, hallelujah. In just the first 15, 20 minutes of your day before you step outside the door, it will break you through. It will break you through some bondages. It will direct you to go the pathway that he wants you to. You might not go drive your same route to work. You might go through a different route, and you'll know that God is doing something and protecting you always, always, always. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. We need to be so sharp in the spirit every morning, every morning, not neglect your time with him, because we need to get closer and closer as the time comes, not further back and further back. Hallelujah. We need to intercede for those that are going backwards instead of progressing. They're regressing. Yes, yes, yes. But we are the people of God that progress. Hallelujah. Yes, hallelujah. We go on to the Canaan land. Amen. Yes. We go on beyond all these little things that the devil tries to put in our pathway, because God has given us, and the Hebrew word is Derek, D-E-R-E-K. God has given us a Derek, which means path. He has given us a path that we need to be on.
Yes.
It's a supernatural path that God has us born on this earth for. We need to tap into that. Glory to God. Get a hold of that. If you think of your life, how he's brought you here and brought you there, and how he's taught you this and he's taught you that, and you're experience this, experience that. He has taken you on a pathway to where he wants you to be.
Ooh, Jesus, thank you.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. If you have these visions and dreams and night visions of you preaching the gospel out there, that's probably your pathway. Hallelujah. If you see yourself laying hands on the sick and they recover, glory to God. That's what the Bible says. Hallelujah. And don't you know that the devil is so threatened by you because you know the word? You know that when you lay hands on the sick, they shall recover. He knows that you know that you can cast out demons in the name of Jesus, and he has to get out. Glory to God. Glory. And even the smallest things, like we were walking this morning.
Hallelujah.
Or riding the bike. I can't remember which one. You know, we were, the littlest thing is we saw some three houses in a row. It's amazing how everybody in the neighborhood has the prettiest houses in the neighborhood, and then some are like, need some help. Well, you know, all of a sudden these houses, people moved in, and one was just poverty stricken and the grass is all grown, and the neighbor poverty stricken, the grass is all grown, and another one, and we're like, you know what, this is contagious. We need to take authority over that in Jesus' name. Father, send help their way, clean them up, get rid of that, you know, wherever there's chaos and mess and overgrown grass and unkempt, you know, the Bible says, you know, look at the what is it, a land that's overgrown is because there's a lazy man somewhere there. And you know what? Lazy can be a synonymous of oppressed, depressed, you know, on drugs, hungover, or just so drunk that they don't care to take care of their homes. And so we prayed at little things. Says, Lord, send help their way. And was it when we walked back? It was a big, lawn company just working on it already. We looked at each other like, praise God. And it's been all these little things that we've been praying for that seem so insignificant that God is showing himself strong in. So never think that the little things that you're concerned about that God is not listening. You know, he hears your prayer, and he wants to give you confidence that anything you ask in his name, it shall be done by my Father which is in heaven. And we need to practice that more and more, because the more bolder that we get, the more God's going to send someone without a limb, and he's going to grow out that limb. Woo! I can't wait for that day. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. But you know, Pastor was preaching about the little foxes. Be careful of the little foxes that spoil the vine. They get in that fence, and a little fox will go in there. And if you have grapevines growing or tomato vines or whatever it is, you know, the foxes will want to nibble on them. And once they start nibbling on these grapes, they destroy a crop. And that's why there has to be a gate. Let's look at that at Solomon 2:15. We're going to go over this quickly. Pastor's been talking about that because God wants us to be in a position as a body of Christ to be ready for signs and wonders and miracles following, because his word says that. Hallelujah. Solomon 2. Hallelujah. Let me find Solomon in my Bible. Hallelujah. Behind Ecclesiastes. Okay. Good hint. I think I marked it, but I took my marker out. Hallelujah. Solomon 2. It says, glory to the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, God, so good. Solomon 2. It says, catch us the foxes, the little foxes that spoil the vines, for our vines have tender grapes. Very simply here, you know, there's a story about this, you know, how the brothers are taking care of the handmaiden, their sister, and you got to, he's saying, you got to be watchful and aware, these little foxes that spoil the vine. Let's look at Ezekiel 13:4. Ezekiel 13:4, it says, Ezekiel chapter 13:4 says, and talking about little foxes. This is talking about judgment upon false prophets. And it talks about the word of the Lord coming. And it says, I'm starting with the beginning right here. The son of man prophesy against the prophets of Israel who prophesy, and say to those who prophesy out of their own heart, hear the word of the Lord. See, not everybody that says, hear ye the word of the Lord, is really the word of the Lord. We have to be careful in this day and age now, even more as the time approaches. Verse 3 says, thus says the Lord God, woe to the foolish prophets who follow their own spirit and have seen nothing. O Israel, your prophets are like foxes in the desert. You have not gone up into the gaps to build a wall for the house of Israel to stand in battle on the day of the Lord. Hallelujah. So he's talking about those little foxes again. And he's talking about mending the gaps and building the wall. You know, we are here not just to, not as a bless me club, as people have coined us. You know, we are here to get everything that is promised to us, because he commands a blessing to us. And the Bible says he commands a blessing to us when there's a spirit of unity. And we're going to get there in Psalms 133. But the little foxes, he says, they spoil things. The vine. And what do we know about the vine? He says, I am the vine. Doesn't he say that? Yes. And doesn't foxes like to spoil that? The foxes are like the enemy that wants to spoil your time with Jesus. He says, abide with me. If you abide with me, I abide with you. Ask what you will, and it shall be done by my Father in heaven. But he says, I am the vine, and you are the branches. You know, we have to branch out. I mean, we have to get the nutrition of the vine. We have to be connected. Hallelujah. So he's telling here in Ezekiel 13:5 that we've not gone up to the gaps to build a house. You're prophesying all this stuff. You're not hearing from God. It's only after you're out of your own spirit. I think this, I think that, I analyze this, analyze that. But is it of the Spirit of God? The only way you're going to know the truth is through the Word of God, because he says, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. And, you know, we've heard that over and over. But the truth, there's truth that humanity is saying, what is truth? What is truth? Truth is only found in the Word of God. Hallelujah. And so he is exhorting, there's gaps in building the wall for the house of Israel. And we want to say that God's spiritual house. We are God's spiritual house of Israel. You know, we need to build a wall. We're building, we're working together, or should be working together to build a wall. But there's gaps in our wall, and foxes are getting in. Right now in Oklahoma City, there's an infestation of sugar ants, little ants. They're harmless, but they sure are pests. Amen. You know, we had to seal some little gaps so they won't get in. Watch out for those crumbs or the sugar or anything. Yes, sweaty clothes, they'll go right after them. Hallelujah. Well, same way, the devil is looking for an entrance.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, the devil is looking for any little old thing. And we are here as a body of Christ in this dispensation, like we said of this evening prayer, that we have we're in the dispensation of grace. And if you look at the timeline, grace is this sliver before the rapture comes, and then the rest of the end of days is. So we need to make the best use of this dispensation of grace that we can, and we need to endeavor to build the wall. You know, for the house of Israel, we need to build a wall for the body of Christ. Build a wall against the enemy. Because he's looking, he's trying to find a way in. And he'll weasel his way in. Hallelujah. Oh, glory to God that, we have his word. Glory to God that we have the Bible to direct us and show us, and the Holy Spirit to warn us. Glory to God. Glory to your name. Glory to your name. We have a real enemy out there.
Yes, right.
And the enemy knows that if he comes straight forward to your face, that he's going to get it. I rebuke you now in the name of Jesus. You get out, you know. So what is he going to do? He's a sneaky snake. He is crafty. He's going to find another way. And he's going to try to find, even if you seal the gap, he's going to try to find that little bitty hole to come in. And he'll find it in ways that just will surprise you. So many ways the enemy will come in. He's a trickster. Let's go into Nehemiah 4. I'm not going to read all of this about building the wall. We'll do that Sunday, God willing. Hallelujah. Nehemiah 4:1, it says, so it happened when Sanballat, you know, he's the enemy, he's synonymous of the enemy. When Sanballat heard that Ezekiel, we in Judah, God's people, when he heard that we were building the wall, that he was so happy they're building a wall and the people are going to be strong again, right?
Yeah.
He said, it says that he was furious and very indignant, and he mocked the Jews. So right when you get solid with Jesus, get solid with your Bible studies, you get solid, well, you're gonna find the mockery of the devil. Say, well, see, you really lost your cool. See what happened? You had this big bill or wreck or whatever, you know. But we're covering that with the blood. That's not going to happen. But when some bad things happen, the devil is just like picking on you all the time. And so he doesn't want you to build the wall. And so let's go down to verse 3. I want you to remember this name, Tobiah. Now, Tobiah the Ammonite was beside him. And he said, see, he was next to Sanballat. And he said, whatever they build, if even a fox goes up on it, he will break down their stone wall. And so here again, there's that word fox. I didn't mean to put that, you know, it's in there. It's like, wow, whatever they build, even a fox goes up on it and it will break it down. It will break down their stone wall. So he's ridiculing whatever wall that you're building. We are building a wall, right? We are working together. We're building a wall of the gospel. The gospel of Jesus Christ. And the enemy is going to say, it's going to fall. You know, a newly saved person, you're not going to make it. You know, it's just too hard for them in the world out there. And the devil says, they got a little short fuse. They're really triggered with anger. And it's a little short fuse there. And, you know, the enemy will use the weaknesses of human nature to get to you. See, that's part of the little foxes. So let's look at verses 6 through 9. So we built the wall, and the entire wall was joined together up to half its height, for the people had a mind to work. Hallelujah. That's the body of Christ. That is the church corporate. We should have a mind to work. And so they build it halfway up to its height. And now when it happened, Sanballat and Tobiah and the Arabs, the Ammonites, and the Ashdodites, all these are idol worshippers, right? They heard that the walls of Jerusalem were being restored, and the gaps were beginning to be closed, that they became very angry. And all of them conspired together to come and attack Jerusalem and create confusion. That's just like the devil that hears, oh, he's got a calling on his life. She's got a calling on his life. And they become very angry. Sometimes even those in your own household. And they said, oh, no, they conspire together. Oh, we need to do something about this. And they create a confusion. And they'll try to confuse you. And they'll try to say, are you really called? Are you really supposed to be there? Are you really supposed to this and that and whatever? And it starts getting to your head, and you start thinking, I wonder if I am supposed to be there. I wonder if the Lord really is supposed to be using me. See, Satan is the author of confusion. Yes, devil likes to confuse. And so this is what they're saying. They became angry, and then they want to create confusion. And that's what they're doing, conspiring together. Verse 9 says, nevertheless, everybody say, nevertheless.
Nevertheless.
Nevertheless, we made our prayer to our God. And because of them, we set a watch against them day and night. Because of these ridicules, because of the devil out there that hates you and wants to stop your ministry and hates you being prosperous and hates you buying new houses and hates you in your new job and your promotion, and he hates when you buy a new car, and he hates all the good things that are happening to you, and he hates these promotions and favor and all these blessings that have come upon you. You know, it says, nevertheless, we made our prayer to our God, because of them conspiring together, because they are angry. Remember that it's the devil, because they are angry. Then what is our action? Just say, oh, well, we're blessed. We can go out. We're blessed. You know, got to take care of them. It's in God's hands. Got to take care of them. You know, but it says, because of them, we set a watch against them day and night. This is where we are right now, body of Christ. We're at the need of setting a watch upon them, the enemy, day and night. The enemy, number one, the enemy of him messing with our mind. He messes with our mind. He torments the mind. You know, he's an evil enemy.
Yes, he is.
You know, his time is short. Uh-huh. And when he messes with you, say, devil, you get behind me, Satan. You know, you are a defeated foe, and your day is, this time is short. You try to put accusations against me. Look at you. You are the most beautiful angel.
Right.
Glorious with colors, and God loved you, and you got booted out of heaven. So get out of here.
Amen.
You know, so he starts accusing you. You remind him of what he did, and you remind him of his destiny and his future. Hallelujah. Let's go to Ephesians 4. This is a way that we are going to fight this thing. As we're praying this morning, we were talking about the great moves of God in the 1800s, the 1700s, and the 1800s, the first awakening, the second awakening, the third great awakening. Now, there was a revival in the entire state of Kentucky.
Yes.
And that there was a group of men in the time of the Civil War, and I don't remember all those dates, that these men would group together in the North and in the South.
Uh-huh.
In the North and in the South, they would have prayer meetings, and you had people being born again in the North and people being born again in the South. Hallelujah. And so, you know, I believe that the end of that was because of prayer.
Yes.
Hallelujah. So in the midst of a battle, one of the most cruelest battles for America, brother against brother, you know, one of the cruelest ones within each other, one of the cruelest battles is not those overseas, are the ones within the house, within the nation.
Yeah.
Amongst that was a prayer revival.
Ooh,
a prayer revival. And then after that came the Azusa revival. 1902, things were beginning to brew up and happening, and then there was the Azusa revival. And then there was a charismatic awakening in 1960, 1966. And then after that was the Jesus movement from which the I came out of.
Yes.
Glory to God. Jesus moved on my heart. Hallelujah. And I became born again. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We say, peace. Jesus loves you. I mean, you know, it was so cool. Headbands and fringe and glory to God. But it was a group of people that were so hungry for God. We're reading that in the charismatic movement in the 1966. You remember that's the times of Woodstock. All the young people were searching for something to, somewhere to belong, something to give them purpose in life. And on the other hand of that was a group of 200,000 teenagers that were waiting for, was it the call, I believe, that started a prayer movement. They were outside of the stadium, and they were so excited about God that they camped out all night. And they decided, no leader, they just decided, let's just pray and praise and pray and praise. 3 o'clock in the morning, they had a 3 o'clock watch. 4 o'clock in the morning, they had a 4 o'clock watch. 5 o'clock in the morning, they had the prayer all night. They were praying. They couldn't wait till 5:30 in the morning. Because at 5:30 in the morning, the gates were open. And they get to pray all together. And so then all of a sudden, double that amount, 400,000 young people gather together to pray for revival. And folks, we are here at that time again in history. I was studying how it took about 50 years from that point. You know, there's the Welsh revivals. Every 50 years, 39 years, 47 years, approximately 50, something great happened. And so right now, from 1977 till now, we got about 11 more years till it's 50 years. But that doesn't necessarily mean it happens on a 50th year, because some happened within 39 years apart that they were breaking through. It matters upon the prayers of God's people. So our revival can happen 11 years sooner. It can happen tomorrow. It can happen this week. It can happen. You know how fast it happens? It happens when our hearts are in unity with one another together. It takes a strong anointing to gather youth together. You know, I guess they just felt it in their hearts to gather all these young people together to pray. And to spend the night all night and pray and pray and cry out for salvation. Thank you, Lord. Those are the times of very heavy drug use, lots of suicides, and Vietnam, and it was a bad time in life. Yes. And we needed prayer. And folks, we're there again.
Yes.
We're there again. Yes. Hallelujah. We need prayer, especially now in election year. We need prayer. We need direction of God. God says, I want my nation back. One nation under God. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Holy Spirit, convict, Holy Spirit. Convict, convict, convict. What do we need to do, Holy Spirit? Hallelujah. We need to have those fire revivals once again. We need to have fresh fire every day. Right before, I mean, when you step out of your bed or before you step out into the world and close the door behind you, you have to have that time together with Jesus. You have to have one word from God to get you to the day. It's fresh oil that you need. You know, we've been counting on the oil from pastor. We've been counting on the oil from other pastors and evangelists, those that have Franklin Graham and Reinhard Bonnke, we're counting on their oil, but we need our fresh oil. We need our own fresh oil. They're all doing a good work because they have a heart for humanity, that not one would be lost to the enemy. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So let's look at Ephesians 4. Ephesians 4. Holy Spirit, we love you, Jesus. It says, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling with which you were called, with all lowliness and gentleness, with long suffering, bearing with one another in love. Long suffering also means patience. You know, that's something that we need to learn. Patience.
Yes, yes.
Remember that, Pastor Robert? We're talking about patience. Yes. Hallelujah. Ye have need of patience, the Lord says. We have to be patient with one another, and we have to be gentle with one another. And love, verse 3, endeavoring. Another word for endeavoring is to guard, to keep the unity of the Spirit. Endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. We got to guard that unity. We got to guard those things that divide us. We got to guard our family ties. Yes, we got to guard our brotherhood, sisterhood ties with one another. We got to guard our children. We got to guard these things that make us one in Christ. We got to guard ourselves against politics, division, against what is that? Prejudice. You know, we got to guard ourselves from those things that divide. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We just thank you, Father, for your word. You got to try your hardest to endeavor to keep the unity of the Spirit. Hallelujah. My footnote here says, showing consideration for others and making allowances for their shortcomings. We got to make allowance for their shortcomings. That means, it doesn't mean that we are, what's that word? Where you allow them, make excuses for them. Can't think of that word. Hallelujah. It's not that. They're making allowances for shortcomings, but these attitudes are the essence of love. They bring unity and peace. Endeavoring, meaning trying your hardest that God has placed us together in the church. We must work at preserving that unity. So yes, it's good to have unity in your families at home because we love one another. We're blood.
Yes.
You know, we're blood at home. Blood is thicker than water. But here it's saying, stronger than that. God has placed us together in the church.
Yes.
We must work at preserving that unity. 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 Guard the unity. Guard those things that divide us. Because together we are strong. Hallelujah. Together we are strong. Let's look at verse 13. You know, it says in verse 12 and 11 and 12 that he gave some apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers for the equipping of the saints, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Verse 13, till we all come to the what? Unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, who is Jesus. To a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. We need to press through so that we have the fullness of Christ in us.
Yes.
Fullness. He's working on us. Amen.
Yes.
He's working on us to be full. Hallelujah. The fullness of Christ. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Until we come to that knowledge of Jesus. It's all about Jesus. It's not about a religion. It's not about a name, a word of faith, or a name, Oasis. It's not about that. It's about Jesus. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Knowledge of Jesus. Let's look at Colossians 3:14.
Yes. Thank you, Father.
God's eternal power company. Glory to God. Colossians 3:14, it says, it's talking about putting on the new man. Hallelujah. Glory to God. It says, bearing with one another and forgiving one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, you must also do. Glory to God. Glory to the name of Jesus.
Thank you,
Jesus. That's not what I... Number 14. But above all these things, put on love, which is the bond of perfection. See, we just read, until we attain the perfection of the knowledge of Jesus Christ. Until we get that perfection... You know, we got to put on love, which is a bond. A bond is a glue. It is a glue. The bond of peace is that glue of peace. Yes. The bond of perfection is that glue of perfection. And that is with knowledge of Jesus Christ. Till we all come to the unity of the faith. Yes. Till we all get to know Jesus, how he thinks, what he's thinking about, how he feels, how he moves, how he quickens. You know, we need to know Jesus at a more intimate level. We need to get into the mind of Jesus to see how he thinks. See how he what would Jesus do? What would Jesus do? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Let's read it all. Let's read it all together, all the way to 17. Therefore, as the elect of God, God's chosen, holy and beloved, put on tender mercies or clothe yourself with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, long-suffering, patience, tolerance. It's my footnotes. Bearing with one another and forgiving one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, you also must do. But above all these things, put on love, which is a bond of perfection, and let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which also you were called in one body, and be thankful. You're all called in one body. Yes. Glory to God. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. Doesn't that sound like those young people waiting for the revival doors to open, that prayer revival? I'm sure that they don't care who had a complaint against them. You know, that they were going to forbear with them. They didn't care about that. They just wanted to commune with Jesus, and they wanted to pray unity for their brother and their sister.
Yes, Father Jesus.
And it says, let the word of Christ, this is a little fox that's trying to steal the word from you. It says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching, admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. So when you have the word of Christ in you, he gives you wisdom what to do. What am I going to do today? He gives you wisdom for decisions that need to be done. So it's the word of Christ in you. You're admonishing one another. Let me tell you what Jesus did for me. Let me tell you what Jesus showed me in the word, and I just learned something. I mean, you're talking with one another, and Lord gave me a song. Hallelujah. And you're worshiping. Verse 17, and whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Oh, hallelujah. The body of Christ should be giving thanks to him for everything. Thanks in faith. Thank you in faith that you're taking care of my problems. Thank you in faith that I don't have to worry. Thank you in faith that you have been delivered from all these things like fear and anxiety and sleepless nights and all these things that the devil tries to rob you of. He tries to rob you of your peace. He tries to rob you with so many things that bombard you in your mind. But let the word of Christ dwell in you. Don't let that little fox get in your wall, get under your wall to steal that abiding vine in Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. 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 In closing, Psalm 133. I don't know about you, but I feel such an urgency in the spirit, such an urgency in the spirit that we get beyond this, that we get this unity, that we get this, hallelujah, this bond, this glue of the Holy Ghost. Excuse me. Psalms 133, it says, behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity.
Yes.
Unity.
Yes.
If you spell those and say out loud the last syllable, it's U-N-I-T-Y. 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 That's unity. You and I tie. We are tied together by the bond of the Holy Spirit, by the bond of perfection, by the bond of love. You and I tie. It says, behold, how good and pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It is like the precious oil upon the head, yes, running down on the beard of Aaron. Aaron was a priest. You know, he was the priest. Hallelujah. He is indicative of Jesus, our high priest. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Like the precious oil upon his head just running down. And you know, Jesus is ahead of the church. He is ahead of the church. And him as head is running down to the body, which is you and you and you. And it's running down, that anointed is running down to the body of Christ because of that unity. And it runs down to the edge of his garments. It's like the dew of Hermon descending upon the mountains of Zion. For there the Lord commanded the blessing, life forevermore. You want the blessing, let's get in unity. You want this church blessed, you get in unity because he commands a blessing. Look at Deuteronomy 28. It tells you there. In Deuteronomy 28, he commands a blessing. So whenever there is such a strong unity that you're going to see souls saved, bondages broken, you're going to see so much blessing, businesses prospering, yes, be totally out of debt. Oh, savings, just finances coming everywhere. Your barns filled with plenty. Your vats overflowing with the new wine of the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
That you're going to be able to see in the spirit. You're going to be able to know the traps of Satan. You're going to be sharper in the spirit than you ever have been before. That is a blessing. I like to see the Marvel comics. Is it that Marvel? What is that? Captain America? I mean, those supernatural powers, man, it just pumps me up. It's like, man, in the spirit, I can go through walls and I can, you know, climb up and throw fires at the devil. And, you know, I just love that. If you imagine that in the supernatural world, you know, we have those same powers, but you may not see it like in the comics, but we have the same power. Ask Thor. Thor knows. He's afraid of us. And I'm glad he's afraid of us. Because he's nothing. His little troops are nothing. Oh, hallelujah. Glory to God. He commands a blessing. Deuteronomy 28:8. The Lord will command the blessing on you and your storehouses and all which you set your hand. And he will bless you in the land which the Lord your God is giving you. So that's the blessings of obedience. In the beginning of chapter 28 says, if you diligently obey the voice of the Lord your God to observe carefully all his commandments, which I command you today, that the Lord your God will set you high above all the nations of the earth.
Yes, Father, we're blessed.
So when he is blessing you and you're observing that, you know, you can't help it because he's commanding it on you. Ooh, you don't have to be stressed. That saying that says, I'm too blessed to be stressed. Because he commands it. He commands a blessing on you. It's on your head, whether you like it or not. Your deal here is to just diligently obey the voice of the Lord. Carefully. And he sets you high. Hallelujah. So that's what the Lord of God is empowering you to do. That's why he wants you to build your wall. Build the wall together. How much in Psalms 133, how much of that anointing do you want? How much anointing do you want? Do you want to be able to walk in the in saints' asylums and have just chains, hear the chains drop from the devil that's got these kids bound, men and women bound with drugs? Do you want to be able to walk in a room and have people just cry, say, lead me to Jesus? Do you want that much anointing on you? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. But we have to endeavor for the sake of the anointing. Endeavor. to get the unity of the faith, to walk in that unity, to guard that unity, to guard that anointing. Hallelujah. We are on the threshold of revival.
Yes, yes.
We are so close there.
Yes, 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 yes.
And we have to recognize that the devil's got us distracted.
Yes. Uh-huh.
Need to get rid of the distractions.
Uh-huh.
And we need to press in together to hear clearly from God. There's a revival in Argentina that happened. I don't remember the year. In the 50s, maybe. I'm not sure. Or later in the 80s. I'm not really sure. But in that revival in Argentina, were four people. It was a pastor, a lady that really didn't believe in God, her husband that was, you know, he was what?
Blind.
He was blind.
Unbeliever.
And one other person. A widow lady, an elderly widow. And they just said, you know, we just want to pray, you know, let's just pray, okay? Let's pray. And when you get an unbeliever to pray, that's something. They're agreeing with you. Even that agreement is unity. So they got in unity, whether they believed it or not. Four of them. They prayed around. You know how you march and you're praying, you're going around, They had a table. There was a tall table, and they prayed, and they marched around, and they're praying, and they're praying, and you know how we pray, oh, Rabasi, Dia, Rabasi, oh, Lord, send us revival, and we're marching, we're praying. Well, they just started marching around this table. They started marching around this table, and the pastor says, any of you feel anything?
Mm-hmm.
Nope. Okay, just keep on praying. And they prayed and prayed, and they kept marching. Okay, anybody else feel anything? Nope. And then a third time, I don't know how many times he asked that. Finally, the lady says, well, I feel this urge every time we march around the table to hit the table. Okay, sister. Okay, well, let's just keep on marching. Let's keep on praying. And she said, I really, it's so strong in me. I feel like hitting the table. Okay, sister, do it. And so they prayed in unity. And Father God, we are praying for revival, Father God. And she hit that table and something just hit the room like a lightning. And the power of God fell upon all of them.
The man saw, he got saved. That's what revival book
of. The man that was blind, he got saved. He got healed. Revival broke out. With four people, revival broke out in the whole nation, in Argentina and all that region there. Revival to where people that were drunk down the street would just come and say, I want to be saved. I want to be saved. Or I feel Jesus. Is there a church around here? You know, that's what we want. You know, if we're not witnessing, we'll let them come to us and say, do you want to be saved? You know, hallelujah. Revival broke out. Four people. And two didn't even believe. But they were just marching around. You know why? They were in unity. They were in unity. You and I tie. You and I tie together. God has brought you here together in this space and time. Together to tie together. We're all the body of Christ. And here and there, God draws all of the bodies of Christ, like in a stadium, to pray. To get together to intercede for this nation, for the lost. And we need to be aware of the foxes that try to get in those gaps. Close up those gaps. Don't let the enemy come in. Don't let the enemy get you in discord. That is the opposite of unity. We have to stay in unity. Husbands and wives, we got to stay in unity. Family members, we got to stay in unity. Hallelujah. Brothers and sisters, we got to stay in unity. You are my brothers and sisters in Christ. We are family. We've been bought by the same blood of the Lamb of Jesus Christ. Glory to God. And when you're in unity, you don't even have to worry about your needs being met because he commands a blessing upon you. All he wants is for you to get in union with him. Get in that prayer place. Get that fresh oil every morning. Freshness, freshness, freshness. If you feel like your oil is stale, then ask God for fresh oil right now. Ask him for fresh oil right now. Hallelujah. Glory to Bashondara Bahasete. Iria la Rabason Dolorobo Shandara Rabasaya. Ira Mando Korobiande Lebekia Sotorobianda. I want to read something to you as we close. It's in the last awakening. He's already gone. David Manuel, he's gone to be with the Lord. He's telling us of the walks of the revivals, the things that have happened, how he was right in the middle of it. And he said, this young man, you know, revival usually breaks out with the unknowns, the unpopular. You know, God is tired of the superstars. It's good to be a superstar for Jesus, but you know what? In the last days, that's not going to matter anymore at all. This guy, his, I can't even pronounce his name. He's Asian Tetsuo. He was a leader of young people and he Young People's Prayer Fellowship. He had a word from God. And I want you to, during his quiet time in the morning, he received a strong word of the Lord that he shared with the rest of them. There's only like 40 people in the room. And he says, you must spend time. This is what the Lord is saying. You must spend time in my presence daily. Before you go on your way, intimacy is everything. What I am calling you to do is not humanly possible. It goes against the grain of human reasoning and ability. That is why you must wait on me. Draw strength from me. I will tell you what to do, what you must do. I will open doors for you. Do not rely upon your own understanding. I will counsel you. But I cannot if you are not abiding in me. And my words are not abiding in you. When you come to the end of yourself, that is where I will come in. Do not fear. Do not be dismayed. For I, the Lord your God, am with you wherever you go. I want to close with that. Father, let us pray. Father, I pray that we do come to the end of ourself and yield unto you, God. It's not about me. It's all about you. Restore the intimacy that we once shared, perhaps at the beginning of our salvation. And Father God, if we have not sought you early, before our day starts, we repent of that now, Lord. We repent of all those things that cause us to be in disunity with you. I see that, Lord. You want us in harmony and in tune with your spirit. He wants us to dance with him, to move with him, to flow with him, to hear his words, to hear the beckoning of his heart for humanity. And Father God, right this moment, we repent from all the things that has stopped us from abiding in the vine. Father, your desire is that we abide with you. You said you'll come in and sup with us, Lord. I see the urgency of the call tonight. I see the urgency, Father God. I pray that not one person that listens to this sermon will forget what you are asking of them, Father God. And we bind up the works of the enemy that will try to steal this word. May it not be forgotten. May it not hit on thorny ground, nor the cares of life or tribulation steal it. In Jesus' name, we rebuke that assignment in Jesus' name. Father, we'll not just hear this word and be glad and go on our merry ways, but we will let it cut to the quick. Pierce our hearts, Lord. Father God, so that we can be in unity with you, Lord. And Father, increase the unity of the body of Christ, Father God. Increase the unity of this body here today, Father God. We see how the enemy has tried so many attempts to divide. And Father God, no more. because we will hear the voice of our Father. We hear you, Lord. You want unity. You want the bond of peace. You want the anointing to flow. You want us to be so strong in the Spirit that when we pray for the nation, it is done immediately, like we've been seeing things happen.
Thank you, Jesus.
When the enemy comes in, like the flood, the Lord will lift up a standard against him. We thank you for that flood, Father God, the cleansing flood, the cleansing flow. Father, you have cleansed us by your blood. And we thank you, Father, for doing that work in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.